Well, I welcome you back to the presentation on analysis of determinate structures. In the last few classes, we had given the concept of the influence line diagram to determine the two internal forces, that is the shear force and bending moment in beams due to moving loads. We had done number of examples considering different types of moving loads. In this discussion, we will start with how to obtain the influence line diagram for axial forces in determinate trusses and use of the same, that is influence line diagram for axial forces, to find the axial forces in specific members of a determinate truss subjected to rolling loads. Now what you see on the picture is a determinate pin jointed plane truss. So when we say determinate, it is a simply supported structure where we have two supports, one is a hinge and the other is a roller. The truss is made of number of triangular panels. So if you just try to identify a truss like this, we say that the truss is determinate. Please understand, if I have one more diagonal member connecting these two joints, it automatically becomes an indeterminate truss because you've got more number of members than what is required. When we do an analysis of pin jointed plane truss, we do make a number of assumptions, like we try to say that the members of the truss are prismatic, that is having the same cross section over the entire length, material is homogeneous, material is isotropic, obviously the material is straight between the two joints, all joints are essentially pin connected, hence we cannot have a fixed support in a pin jointed plane truss, we can have hinge support and roller support, and all these members are lying in the same plane. Now we try to talk about the loads. The only load we are trying to apply on this truss is a concentrated load which is applied at the joints. Okay, the joints are pins. Okay, so please understand they are smooth, frictionless joints. So whenever we try to apply concentrated loads at the joints of this kind of trusses, we are trying to basically move the joints to new positions or locations, and since the members are interconnected, even if you apply loads at few joints, other joints are also bound to move. Since the joints are only being pushed, the member is not loaded on its length. Please understand that the orientation of the members may slightly change when the joints move, but still the members remain straight, okay, between the two displaced joints at the ends of the member. So the distance between the two joints of a member may either increase or decrease when this happens. If the distance between the two joints increase, the member is in tension. On the other hand, if the distance between the two joints decrease, then the member is in compression. So this is a very simple explanation that we are trying to talk about in pin jointed plane truss. Hence we need to understand that in pin jointed plane truss, because the members do not bend, they don't have bending moments, and since there is no bending moment, there will be no shear force. So the only internal force a member of a truss will have is an axial force. Axial forces can be either tensile or compressive. Okay, so this is what we are trying to understand in this discussion. In bridges, trusses are normally used when the spans are large. Obviously, generally the bridges have large spans, so we are trying to make use of trusses to support the loads. There are two types of bridges or trusses that we can think of in bridges. The first one is called as the through type bridge, and the second one is called as the deck type bridge. Now let us try to understand what is a through type truss bridge. Now this is a typical truss where it is simply supported, made of number of members. All joints are connected by frictionless smooth hinges. Individual members are straight. Now in a bridge, please understand, there would be two trusses, okay, lying on the either side, okay, of the pavement. So what you are seeing on the right hand side is nothing but the, okay, side view, okay, of this truss. This is the side elevation, okay, this is the elevation seen from the side, and this is the side view, okay, of this particular truss. So you are trying to see, okay, a truss on the left side of the bridge, and you are trying to see a truss on the right side of the bridge. Okay, the two trusses which are lying on either side of the road or the pavement in the bridge are connected, okay, in this particular case at the bottom cords, okay, they are connected, and they're connected by a beam which we call as the main beam. The main beam connects the two trusses. Here it is at the bottom of the truss they are being connected. Now just try to understand that, just to give you more clarity. So we have vehicles, okay, which are running, okay, perpendicular to the cross section that you're trying to see here. So the bridge generally is large, so you can think of, okay, two or more than two vehicles, okay, moving on the bridge. So the vehicle is, okay, either coming out of the screen or going into the screen. Again, if you just try to check these vehicles onto the bridge, so that's how you can expect the vehicles to run, okay, on the bridge. I hope trying to understand, okay, the movement would be in that particular direction. Now if we look at the plan of the bridge at the bottom card, okay, it is something like this. So what you are trying to see is the plan of the bridge at the bottom card. Okay, so we have the truss arrangement, okay, on this side of the road. You got the truss arrangement on the other side of the road or the pavement. Please understand, the two trusses are connected by main beams. There are five main beams, okay, which are connecting the two trusses at the five joints present in the bottom card. Okay, so we just try to count here. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. There are five joints, okay, along the bottom card. So we have got five joints on this side of the truss, you've got five joints on the other side of the truss. Okay, the joints are connected by beams. We call this as the main beams. Okay, so please understand, the main beams are further connected by beams which run parallel to the truss. They are smaller beams when compared to the main beams and are called as secondary beams. So what you can understand here is, generally whatever load that is applied on the bridge, okay, is first transferred onto the secondary beam. From the secondary beam it is transferred onto the main beam, and from the main beam it will be transferred onto the joints of the two trusses, okay, left truss and right truss, okay, and from that point, from that joint, okay, the load is transferred onto the supports of the bridge. So this is how you can expect the flow of forces. So from the floor it goes to the secondary beam, from the secondary beam it goes to the main beam, from the main beam it will be transferred on to the both the trusses, okay, in some way, okay, some way, right, equilibrium equations. And from the truss, it goes to the supports. So here we call this as a through bridge because the vehicles move inside the bridge, through the bridge. That is why we call this as the through type truss bridge. Let us try to go to the next type of bridge. The next type of bridge that we are talking about is the deck type truss bridge. Now just try to look at the arrangement of the deck type bridge. Okay, so please note that, okay, at the top, okay, you got the top cards and the bottom card arrangement is something like this. They are connected by intermediate cards like this. So that is a typical elevation. And if you just look at the side view, okay, so that is the left part of the truss. That's the right, the right side. You've got one more truss. The two trusses are connected together at the top cards. Last time it was connected at the bottom card. Here the two trusses are connected at the top cards. So you can clearly see the vehicle moving, okay, on the top cards of the bridge, or not necessarily on the main beams, connecting the top cards of the bridge is what you are trying to understand. You can also have vehicles, okay, more than one vehicles coming onto the bridge. You can expect that the vehicles move like that. Okay, so this is how you can expect the vehicles to move, okay, on the bridge. And since they are moving on the deck slab, okay, on the floor of the bridge, open, okay, we call this as a deck type bridge. Regarding the plan of the bridge, okay, at the top card, the arrangement is very similar to what we saw, okay, at the bottom card of the through type bridge. So here you on the this is nothing but the truss at one side of the bridge or one side of the pavement. This is a truss on the other side of the pavement. Okay, so the two trusses are connected with each other, okay, by main beams, okay, which connect the joints of the trusses, okay, at the top cards. Further, the main beams are again connected by secondary beams which run, okay, parallel to the two trusses. So as we discussed earlier, so load, okay, from the floor goes to the secondary beam. From the secondary beam it goes to the main beam, and from main beam it gets transferred to both the trusses, and from each truss it goes to the support. So this is how you can expect the flow of forces in case of pin jointed plane truss bridges. Now let's try to understand very briefly regarding the methodology to analyze pin jointed plane truss using ILD, which carries moving loads. Now in case of trusses, we are trying to draw influence line diagram for the only internal force present, which is nothing but an axial force. If you quickly recollect in the last discussion where we considered analysis of beams, we had drawn ILD for bending moments, ILD for shear force, because those two were the internal forces in that component or in that structure beam. Whereas in case of pin jointed plane truss, the only internal force is axial force. So we will be trying to plot the influence line diagram for axial forces. Please understand, when the load moves on the truss or bridge, okay, the various members of the truss experience different axial forces. Okay, so as the for any given position, even the axial forces will be different in each and every member. Okay, and again, as the vehicle moves, the axial force keeps on changing in a particular truss member. So normally we try to obtain the ILD for axial forces in members of the truss using method of joints. Okay, so we'll be method of sections, which we'll be trying to do when we take numerical examples. You will understand. And members in a truss can be either vertical, inclined, or horizontal. If the members are vertical and inclined, Okay, the axial forces in these members are related to the support reactions. It could be the left or to the right, and that's how we try to obtain the influence line diagram. Okay, so once we try to understand the relation, we can use this to plot the ILD for axial force in these members. It's a very simple concept. So if the truss is a member, we're trying to draw ILD for each member. If the member is either vertical or inclined, we try to connect the influence line diagram of that member with the reactions. So obviously we will be trying to draw the influence line diagram for the reaction VA, VB, and then we try to connect the two. However, for horizontal members, so we try to relate the moment at some specific joint in a panel joint in a free body of the truss, considering one of the cut sections, and then try to relate the axial force in these members with respect to that joint. So I'll repeat. So we try to have a truss. We are trying to find the ILD for a horizontal member. As usual, we try to cut the truss at the point where we are trying to determine the force, axial force, that is horizontal member gets cut. You get two portions. Then we try to consider one of the portions. We try to obtain an expression for the moment at a joint in one of the cut sections, which is convenient. And then try to obtain the influence line diagram for the moment at that joint, which will be related to the axial force, in that particular member. So again, we are trying to connect the ILD. ILD of axial force is obtained by from the ILD of BM drawn to that point, with suitable modification. Now just try to check, we understand how to draw the influence line diagram for reactions, VA, VB. So whatever you have learned earlier for beams remain the same even when in this particular case. So we have a truss, assume it, the span is L, that is distance between the two ends A and B. So the influence line diagram for support reaction A is a triangle having the maximum ordinate of 1 at support A. It's a right angle triangle. So regarding ILD for B, it is very similar. So you have maximum ordinate at B, the value of ordinate at A is 0, so you are trying to join the two by a straight line. So we'll be trying to use these ILDs in our calculations. Apart from that, we also would like to know the influence line diagram for moment at a suitable joint. So for example, I want to calculate the influence line diagram for BM at C. So it looks like a triangle. So C is trying to divide the span in a ratio of A and B. So A plus B equal to L. So the ordinate of ILD for BM at C is AB by L. So we'll be using these two ILDs that we have learned in the last few classes for beams. So the same are extended here, but we are trying to connect these with the influence line diagram of the axial force for any member of a truss. Please understand, there is no bending moment in any truss member, but we are using this to obtain the influence line diagram of axial force in all horizontal members. So with this small introduction, so let us try to take a numerical example connected with how to talk about obtain the influence line diagram for three typical members, that is a incline, a vertical member, an inclined member, and a horizontal member, in a given pin jointed plane truss. And you will later use that to find the maximum force developed in these three members, that is FC, FD, and FG, when a moving load UDL of intensity 40 kN per m longer than the span crosses the truss from left to right on the bottom card. So the moment you say bottom card, you'll realize that this is a through type bridge. So this is a different arrangement of members. Okay, so if you just try to check here, right, so we have totally seven joints at the bottom card, seven joints at the top card. Okay, and if you just try to look at the supports, these joints are connected by straight members. Regarding the supports, there are two supports. One is a hinge at A and the other is a roller at B. Okay, so all joints are pin connected. You can see a lot of triangular elements panels present here. So you can easily say that the truss is determinate. Okay, regarding the size of each panel, the height of the truss is 4 meters. Okay, the distance between the two joints, okay, along the length of the truss is again 4 meter. So 6 into 4 is 24 meter. The span of this truss is 24 meters. So you can easily understand that the height is 4 meters. The each distance between each joint in horizontal direction is 4 meters. So the inclination of the inclined members will be 45 degrees. This you can understand. Now let's try to check what are the members that we are trying to which members we are trying to find the axial force. It is one is member FC, then we are trying to with in member FD, and the last one is in member FG. So these are the three members in which we are trying to determine the value of the axial force. Okay, so let us try to start. Okay, so let us start with member FC. So we just try to recollect, we said that we are trying to obtain the influence line diagram using method of sections. So what we have to do is, first we are going to cut the truss into two parts such that the cutting section should essentially pass the member, okay, that we are trying to in which we are trying to find the axial force. So to begin with, we are trying to say we are trying to determine the axial force in member FC. Okay, hence if you just try to look at the cutting plane, okay, my cutting plane passes through FC, but not only that, it is also passing through EF and CD. Please understand that, okay, the cutting plane should be taken such that, okay, once you take this cutting plane, the truss is physically divided into two parts. And the cutting plane should not pass more than three members, okay, right, because initially we will not be knowing the forces in any of the members. Once I cut the members, the internal force will get released, okay, and when I do that, I should not have a situation where I have cut four members and four internal forces get released. For example, look at this, I could also have cut, okay, member FC in this direction, if I cut like that, look at that, four members, okay, will get cut, like one is FC, one is FD, one is FC, okay, right, three, maybe five, like there's one more member EC and then one more horizontal member. I guess if I do that, five members, okay, get cut if I do like this, right? So that is not possible. So we are trying to cut the member like this, okay, and physically divide two parts. And now regarding the formulation of influence line diagram, as you can clearly see here, we are trying to obtain the influence line diagram considering three cases here. Case one, okay, unit load between A and C. Case two, that means from this point to this point. Case one, let the unit load between anywhere between A and C, then between D and B, okay, and finally between C and D, correct? So we will be leaving that panel, okay, where this section passes through in the bottom part. So we are trying to say initially, let the unit load be anywhere between A and C, let the unit load be anywhere between D and B, and finally we are trying to tackle that unleft portion in the horizontal part, that is CD finally. So this is case 3, not case 2. The last one is case 3. Okay, so this is what we have done. We have cut the member like that. Okay, I just pushed the two slightly apart. Okay, so we have physically cut the two members, something like this. Okay, we'll be considering each of these portions. Okay, when we are doing the calculations, initially we are trying to say let the unit load be between A and C. That means in the portion, okay, let it be between A and C. Right? Now please understand, okay, which is this portion? Left portion. I am trying to say that unit load is in the left portion, okay, of the truss, somewhere between A and C. Okay, please understand, once I do that, when I try to do the calculations, I am trying to determine the influence line diagram in portion AC, I will be trying to consider the free body diagram of the right side portion. So what you are trying to see on the figure is the free body diagram of the right portion of that truss which I have cut. Now please understand, okay, we try to get an internal force at each cut section. Okay, the cutting plane has passed through, okay, three members, and understand three internal forces get released here. The direction of these internal forces will be oriented in the direction of that member, and we assume that all members are tensile, the member forces, all member forces are tensile, and hence you write the direction of these tensile forces as away from the cutting plane. Okay, so here I have written the three members as F suffix EF, F suffix FC, and F suffix CD. So these are the three member forces that get released when I cut these members, that is EF, FC, and CD. Okay, so, and please understand, once I talk about the free body diagram, I should also write the vertical reaction at B at the support. You got a support at B, and understand that I have to write the support reaction also at B, that is B suffix B, and I have marked it upwards. Okay, now please understand, now I apply a simple equilibrium equation here, that is simple equilibrium equation is sigma sum of all moments, forces, algebraic sum of all forces acting in y direction equal to 0 with an appropriate sign convention, say forces upwards as positive. There are only two forces acting on this in this part of the structure. One is the reaction VB and the other is the internal force FC. Okay, internal force in member FC. Please understand, okay, just try to look at that assumption we have said. Let the unit load be between A and C. So unit load is not present in this portion of the truss. So we are trying to avoid, okay, the unit force on this section, and then we are trying to understand how we can get the ILD for AC in that portion. Okay, so apply sigma Fi equal to 0, assuming forces, upward force is positive. So we get plus VB minus F suffix, okay, FC equal to 0. Okay, or F suffix F, force in this member FC is nothing but the vertical reaction at B, and understand you got a plus sign, so that means it will be tensile. Okay, the force is tensile. Okay, so please understand, okay, the axial force in member FC will be straight away equal to the vertical reaction at B. So that's what we have established. Okay, but please understand the value of VB keeps on changing, okay, as the load changes, unit load changes. And we, if you just try to quickly understand that, okay, so we have said that let the unit load lie between A and C. Let the unit load lie between A and C. Okay, so since the ILD of, since the force is expressed in terms of VB, I am writing the appropriate influence line diagram. So the influence line diagram for ILD for VB looks like a triangle. Okay, the base of the triangle covers the entire span, that is 24 meters. The maximum height of the ILD is 1 at support B. It is 0 at support A. The two ordinates vary or linearly. So we have joined them by a straight line. And please understand, we have said that let the load lie anywhere between A and C. So first let us try to determine the ordinates, okay, in ILD for VB, vertical reaction at B. okay, at the boundaries, that is at A and C, because we have said let the unit load lie anywhere between A and C. So as you can clearly understand that the ordinate of influence line diagram at A is 0, okay, you can quickly calculate what is the ordinate, okay, at C, right, the end of the movement of unit load, right, the ordinate in ILD at C, okay, you can clearly check that at 24 meters it is 1, okay, at 8 meters what is the value, 8 by 24 is 1 by 3, that is 0.33. So this information, okay, we will be using, right, okay. So once you have done this, we apply the boundary conditions and then try to find out how the ILD is going to vary between point A and point C, correct. So we know the relation that F suffix FC equal to VB, and that is tensile. Okay, when the unit load is as at A, right, the value of VB is 0. We just saw that in the previous case. If you just try to check here, go back, okay, so we can easily say that, okay, the value of VB, right, is 0, okay, when the reaction unit load acts at A. Okay, so we are trying to substitute that. Okay, so we know that FFC equal to VB at A, VB equal to 0. Just try to substitute the value of VB here, 0. You get the force in member FC, which is equal to VB, equal to 0. Now, regarding the other boundary, okay, the maximum distance to which it can move right now we have said is C. So at C, what is the value of VB? So just try to go back, okay, we'll see that the ordinate we had got at C in ILD for VB is 0.33. So we are just trying to use that information here. So when the load is at C, the value of VB is 0.33. Okay, hence we can easily calculate the force in member FC by using this simple relation, which is VB. So that would be equal to, okay, 0.333. Okay, so directly. So please understand, we have got the ordinates at point A and point C. So point A is 0, point C it is plus 0.333. Plus means, okay, it is tensile, is what you need to understand. The plus sign there indicates it is tension, and the variation from A to C, okay, is linear straight line. Okay, why? Because it's a determinate truss. Okay, now let's try to go to the next case. That is, the load is between D and B. So earlier we said it is between A and C. Okay, this one. Now we are trying to say let the load lie between D and B. Let it lie between D and B. Correct? So when you're trying to consider the right portion, assuming that the unit load is at the right portion, we try to take the free body of the left portion. Why we do this? Basically because we want to avoid the unit load present in that region free body diagram. Okay, so we always try to say that the UDL the unit load is in the other part of the free body diagram, and then we are trying to handle this part, okay, of the free body diagram. Okay, so that does not come into the calculations. Otherwise, if I try to say sigma Fi plus 0, I should also consider the unit field load. Okay, now I have tried to I've shown the same sketch. I've cut the truss into two parts physically through that cutting plane XX, and the I've chosen the cutting plane that it passes through member FC, and not more than three is the maximum number of members, okay, that get cut if I try to take the cutting plane, okay, in this fashion. Okay, now having considered the free body diagram of the left portion of the truss, because I've assumed the unit load to be present between D and B, okay. So at these cut sections, okay, three cutting points, the internal forces get released. Okay, there are three internal forces I have written here: F suffix EF, F suffix FC, and F suffix CD. Please understand, all forces, unknown forces, are marked as tensile away from the cutting section. At support, I have written the support reaction, that is V suffix A. Right. So I think the free body diagram is fine, complete. Okay. Now let me just try to apply an appropriate equilibrium equation to know the value of the force F suffix FC. So to determine F suffix FC, now I'm trying to use again another simple equilibrium equation. sum of all vertical forces equal to 0 with a sign convention, say F word positive. So I get this as plus F V suffix A plus F suffix FC equal to 0. Okay, or I'm going to get this as F suffix FC equal to minus VA. Please understand, last time it was plus VB, now we are getting minus VA. Okay, minus indicates what? It indicates compression. Okay, so please understand that. Okay, so when the unit load is anywhere between A and C, right, it is bound to understand that, okay, the force experienced in member FC is compressive, and that will be equal to the numerical value of VA. So my next task is to plot the influence line diagram, okay, of the reaction VA, of the reaction VA. Why am I doing this? Because right now the force in member FC is expressed in terms of reaction VA. So the ILD for reaction VA looks like a triangle. It has a maximum ordinate of 1 at support A and 0 at support B. Okay, and you can just try to check that at the boundary. The boundary that we are trying to take is, we have said let the load lie anywhere between D and B. I would like to determine the ordinate, okay, in ILD at the boundaries. So the one of the boundaries D, another boundary is B. Okay, the value of the ordinate at D is 0.5. It is exactly at mid span. Okay, the value of the ordinate at B is 0. Okay, as you can clearly see in this particular sketch. So once we have got this, we try to determine the ordinate, the ordinate of ILD, right? Okay, so between at the boundaries, okay, that would be at the D point and the B point, correct? Now, when the load is anywhere between A and C, so we have obtained the expression for the axial force in member FC equal to minus times VA. We have got this as minus VA. So let us try to substitute the values of reaction VA, okay, when the unit load is at appropriate boundary. Okay, one of the first boundary that we are trying to talk about is, okay, at a D. So when the unit load is at a D, what is the value of VA? So we just try to go back to the slide. So that means when the unit load is at D, the ordinate is 0.5, correct? So I just try to use that information here. Okay, so we know that F suffix FC equal to minus VA. The value of VA is plus 0.5, minus to plus becomes minus. So we try to say that F suffix FC is minus 0.5, correct? So we have to even consider the unit load, okay, at the other boundary, which is B. And if you just try to go to the previous slide, so the value of ILD, ordinate of ILD VB is 0, okay? So of VA is 0 at B. So I'm just trying to use this information back here, right? So when the unit load is at B, the value of B equal to 0. Okay, we have got the relation as FFC equal to minus VA or FFC equal to 0. Again, the variation between the C point and the D point are linear. That is, they vary, okay, in a linear way. Okay, so if you just try to quickly recollect, we have drawn ILD, determined ILD in portion AC. We also determined the ILD in portion DB. Now we have that intermediate portion, that is CD. Please understand that, okay? So that means once we have finished the influence line diagram for AC and DB, we are left with CD. Okay, so please understand this important thing. We are not trying to do anything extra here. We try to say that the influence line diagram, okay, right, between C and D for member FC varies linearly. Okay, from what value to what value? It's nothing but plus 0.33 tension at C and minus 0.5 compression at B. So we just try to put this particular line, okay? So we just try to connect the two ILDs, okay? ILDs which we have determined in portion AC and DB, we connect the two by a straight line. So if we just try to carefully observe the plot of ILD for axial force, right, for member FC, this is how it looks like, okay? So we have got the baseline here, we got the baseline, right? Okay, so we just try to check here, first draw the baseline. Okay, then we'll concentrate on portion AC. So we have said that, okay, at A the value is 0, okay, it is 0, and at the value of C it is plus 0.33. so initially we connect, okay, this ordinate 0, okay, and plus 0.33 by a straight line, Okay. Next, we talk about constructing influence line diagram in portion DB. Correct. So the value of the axial force when the at D is 0.5. That is minus 0.5 is what we have got, and the value of the ordinate, okay, at B is 0. So you can clearly see that we are trying to join the two by a straight line. Okay, but please understand this is negative, that is positive. Next, we join the two ordinates, that is plus 0.33 and minus 0.5, okay, in that portion CD. So once I finish this, we are through with obtaining the influence line diagram, okay, for member FC, right? So it is complete. So please understand, important thing to observe is there is a crossover of the influence line diagram in CD. So if you just try to use similar triangles, you can try to get at what point, okay, this influence line diagram will intersect the horizontal line. So please understand, it is calculated as it is 1.6 meters, okay, from C, and 2.4 meters from D. So put together is nothing but 4 meters, okay, the size of each panel. Okay, so this is what we have done right now. Okay, so that is we have got the influence line diagram, complete influence line diagram, okay, for axial force of member FC. Now, having got the influence line diagram, we make use of it to calculate maximum tension developed in the member and minimum tension, maximum tensile force, maximum compressive force, okay, developed in the truss member. Okay, and for that to happen, okay, how do you place the load? So we just try to recollect, we had said that the type of load that the truss is subjected to, okay, is an UDL of length longer than the span. So we don't have any issue with respect to the placement of the UDL. It is quite long. Okay, so even if you just try to check that this is a 24 meter span, it is possible for me to place this UDL over the entire span, because the length of the UDL is more than the span. Okay, now what we want is maximum tensile force in member FC. So if you want maximum tensile force in member FC, so what I'll be doing is I'll be trying to check, is it all right? Okay, so in my ILD, right, so where is the, from which point to which point we have got the positive ordinates. So the positive ordinates, okay, right, are present right from A to somewhere at 1.6 meters, okay, beyond C, 1.6 meters beyond C. So having observed this, I will try to place the UDL on the bottom card, because the movement happens in the bottom card here, so through type of a bridge, okay, such that the front end of the UDL, okay, whose length is longer than the span, is exactly placed at 1.6 meters to the right of C. Okay, and obviously the remaining load lies to the left of that particular point. Okay, so having placed the load appropriately, why have we placed like this? Because I want the maximum area of the positive ordinates. So I have enough length, so I'm just trying to cover the entire positive portion of the ILD. So once I have done this, okay, I just try to go to the calculation part. So if you just try to check the calculation part here, so we are trying to just use the simple expression, that is something called intensity of load multiplied by the shaded portion. So just try to check the shaded portion. So I've just tried to hatch the entire positive region, because my UDL is positioned to cover the entire positive portion. So having done this, we try to just multiply the intensity of load multiplied by the hatched portion, okay, of that ILD, correct, and that will give us the maximum tensile force, okay, present in member FC. So we get maximum tension in member FC equal to intensity of UDL multiplied by area in ILD under UDL, okay, or max T, that is tensile force, is equal to intensity of load is 40. Now regarding the shaded portion of the ILD, it's a triangle, we write as half base height. Okay, so what is the base here, right? It is from A to C, it is 8 meters, Beyond sea, it is 1.6 meters. So total base of this triangle is 9.6. Height is 0.333. So 9.6 and 0.333. So we just try to use the appropriate relation here. That is 0.5 into 9.6 into 0.333. So that is nothing but 63.94 kN is the maximum tensile force. Okay, that member FC experiences, okay, when the moving UDL longer than the span crosses the beam. Okay, so this is the tension that we have here. Please understand, a member can also develop a force of opposite nature for some position of load. Okay, and we are trying to determine the maximum compressive force that this particular member may experience. So for which again I come back to the influence line diagram that I have obtained or developed, okay, for this member FC. Okay, so I'm just trying to use the same influence line diagram. As you are trying to see here, okay, you got a negative ordinates, that is ordinates below the baseline, okay, from okay some point between C and D, which is nothing but 2.4 meters to the left of point D, and it goes up to point B, that is support B. So in this region you can clearly make out that okay the ordinates are negative. Okay, so obviously this states that if you just try to put any load, okay, in portion this portion we have got the member that is in portion this defined portion, that is DB, right, the member experiences compressive force. So my next task is to think about the load that I have been given. So the load that has been given is an UDL longer than the span. So I don't have an issue with respect to the coverage area. I can cover whatever area that I want in this particular case. I have to cover the total distance of 12 meters, that is D to B, and beyond D 2.4 meters. So I would be trying to spread the UDL for a length of 14.4 meters. Okay, so this is what you need to understand. I have just placed the load appropriately. Now I have to calculate the area. Okay, so the area in this particular case is nothing but the entire shaded portion that you are trying to see, okay, below the UDL, which covers the entire negative portion of the ILD. Now how do I get the area? Half base height. Okay, what is the base that we are trying to have here? 12 plus 2.4, that would be 14.4, and the height of the ordinate is 0.5. Okay, so I just use the expression, that is maximum compression in member FC is nothing but the same expression, intensity of UDL multiplied by area in ILD under UDL. Correct? So what is the intensity of UDL? 40. What is the area in ILD? Area in ILD under UDL, it is half base height, 0.4 into 14.4 into 0.5. Okay, that would be 144 kN. Okay, now when we took this particular example, please understand, we said that we are trying to find, first construct the influence line diagram, okay, something like this, okay, for the member, right? So this is a typical ILD that we constructed, okay, for member, one of the members FC. Okay, however, we have to repeat the problem for the other two members, okay, FD and FG, which we'll try to take up in the next class. But however, if you quickly recollect how we did this example, is it all right? It's quite important to understand that we used a method of sections. Okay, and when you try to take a section here, okay, the section should pass through the member FC, okay, in which we are trying to find the force, and then the two other members, okay, in the truss. Once it happens, the truss is divided into two parts, and then we try to say that to begin with, okay, let the unit load be between AC in this particular case, and then we take the free body diagram of the right portion. Okay, we always take the free body diagram of that portion where the unit load is not present. Okay, so we try to do that. Okay, when I'm trying to say unit load is between AC, I consider the FBD of the right portion of the truss. Okay, and then apply a simple equilibrium equation. Okay, F suffix say Y equal to 0, and then I connect the axial force in member FC with reaction VB. Okay, so I should understand that I should get the ILD for VB, right? And then use appropriate values and then express, okay, the force in member FC in terms of that reaction VB. Similarly, next choice I said, let the unit load be between D and B. Okay, now it is in the right portion. Okay, when the unit load is between D and B, I take the other portion, left portion. Okay, then I draw the free body diagram, I'll have cut forces, okay, exposed in all the three members. Okay, then I've got the reaction VA, I apply again a simple equilibrium equation sigma if I equal to 0, then connect the force in vertical member FFC with vertical reaction at A. So the moment you understand this, we draw the ILD for VA, okay, in this particular case, then we try to take coordinates at the boundaries of the load, that is at D point and B point, substitute that in the expression and again express the force, okay, FFC, right, in terms of VB, and then we have understood how to put and get the values at the boundary. So once you have done the construction of ILD in portion AC and portion DB, right, next in between BAC and DB, try to join it by a straight line. Okay, so this is how we have done it, and please understand, okay, we'll try to do the same approach procedure, okay, for the next member, okay, that we are supposed to determine, that is FD and followed by FG. So FD is very similar to FC, because we have said that for vertical and inclined members, we'll be constructing influence line diagram connecting the vertical reactions, whereas for horizontal member, we'll be connecting that with the moment. Okay, so I think with this we will stop the discussion connected with this presentation. Right, in the next presentation, we will try to continue this problem, okay, and then try to see how we try to obtain the influence line diagram for axial force in members FD and FG. Thank you.